Welcome to the latest podcast from ProLongevity, hosted by Graham Phillips, the pharmacist who gave up drugs and helps people live a healthier, longer life. In this special three-part series, we're exploring a controversial campaign for a statin-free life, led by world-renowned cardiologist Professor Aseem Malhotra. Today we'll find out about statins and the consequences of corporate greed, and explore alternative, drug-free ways to reduce your health risk.
You were described, I think, in the Daily Mail as a statin denier.
The Mail on Sunday.
Graham, was it the Mail on Sunday?
So, and the reason it's important is I've had done a lot of good work with Daily Mail over the years. Completely different editor. People often confuse them. They're completely different editors, different editorial policy. So, yeah, it was the Mail on Sunday specifically. Yes, absolutely. They accused myself, Malcolm Kendrick, and Zoe Harkham. I think an editorial was written saying that a place belongs in hell for people that say statins don't work, which was referencing to us three. But I've never said statins don't work. So it was basically just a nonsense article. In fact, there was a complaint, official complaint made to the Press Complaints Commission. I think that's what they're called. But unfortunately, you know, the regulations around what the press do and that kind of stuff is very weak. So you don't really get very far. But, you know, it was kind of, it was essentially nonsense, you know. But actually, I took it as a backhanded compliment, really. Because if you're getting attacked in, you know, newspapers like the Mail on Sunday, it means you're clearly
you're having an impact.
So I was actually pleasantly kind of I was quite pleased, in fact, in a way, indirectly, that was happening, because it means I'm having an impact.
My only regret was that I wasn't named in that article, because, you know, I'm the pharmacist. I'm the pharmacist that gave up drugs.
The badge of honour, Graham.
Yes.
If you get smeared by the Mail on Sunday, the Daily Mail, then it should be a badge of honour, really.
But
put it on your CV, actually.
Exactly. Yeah. But I think there is a broader
point. Might help
you
get honours from the Queen or something like that.
I think there's a broader point here, which is neither of us are actually a statin denier. We've got an issue with statins, which is going to lead on to my next question.
Yeah.
But I don't think either of us would take the position that statins are just never useful and should never be prescribed and be wiped off the face of the earth. So I think we both agree that there is a place for statins.
Yes.
Is that a fair thing
Absolutely.
To say?
Absolutely. This is about the overprescription of a drug, which helps the small minority of people, in particular those with established heart disease, who've had heart attacks. And it's the fact that there is not true informed consent going on when we prescribe these pills to patients. So this is about medical ethics more than anything else.
So there is a percentage of people. I mean, I know that you've written that you do prescribe statins. Now, if you're a complete statin denier, which is a ridiculous cult-like term, you wouldn't do that. And I've just been on the phone to one of my own clients, who's actually he's been talking to Scott Murray, and Scott encouraged him to take a statin. Now, for him, I think there's absolutely every indication. So I just think we need to have a nuanced message here, which is, you know, these things are complicated. There is a place for statins. But what is that place?
So Graham, I think the important thing, so in people with established heart disease who've had a heart attack, the absolute individual benefit from taking a statin over a 5-year period, if you trust the industry sponsored trial data completely. So this is best case scenario.
Absolutely.
Okay. So unlikely to be true, but as close as possible as we can get.
Yeah.
It's 1 in 39. In preventing a non-fatal heart attack, and 1 in 83 in delaying your death or saving your life. But the key thing is you have that conversation with the patient, which is what I do. Now, interestingly, when you look at data on these absolute risk reduction, and you look at other interventions in terms of would a patient choose to take the pill with that benefit, level of benefit, about a third of them would say no. And in fact, one case study I wrote up in the pharmaceutical journal, which actually became the most read, I think, for the pharmaceutical journal that year in 2018, was actually about a patient of mine called Tony Royal, who's a former in Atlantic and suffered a heart attack. And you know, he couldn't fly anymore. So he went back to teaching maths and physics. So he's quite a smart chap and good with numbers. And once he looked at the data himself and understood it, he decided that a statin wasn't for him. He also experienced side effects, but you know, he made an informed decision not to take a statin. And he was someone who had a heart attack, the kind of person that Scott Murray may have encouraged to take the pill. I'm sure Scott would have had an informed discussion with that patient.
Absolutely, yeah.
But so that even for those patients, many of them choose not to take it. I have many patients that choose not to take it. And I always write to the GP or the doctor and saying, well, we've had a fully informed discussion here. And the patient has made a choice and understood what I've said and made a choice not to take a statin. And they should be fully supported in that decision. Yeah. Unfortunately, what happens, Graham, and I get many patients coming to me for second opinions where a doctor, a GP, but more often than that, either a lipid specialist or a cardiologist has scared them so much to the extent where they've been told if they don't take a statin, they've got a prognosis like someone with terminal cancer, which is complete nonsense. Which is complete nonsense. And then I have to reassure the patient and explain it to them in real terms. I don't think the doctors are deliberately doing this. I think this is basically a lack of knowledge, really. Yeah. It's a lack of understanding, and it's too much putting too much trust in medical guideline bodies that, unfortunately, as we know, are heavily influenced by the pharmaceutical industry.
Yeah.
But it's our duty and job, you know, to patients and scientific integrity to do the right thing. So this is really what this book is also about, is trying to encourage people to think a little bit more about what is their role as a doctor? What are they actually trying to do for patients? And what information are they using to make clinical decisions?
I think that's so important. I mean, I have got the same experience, which is that a lot of my clients are on a statin for no particular reason other than the protocol demands it and the GP, and I'm not criticizing my GP colleagues, it's the way the system works.
Yeah, this is a system failure issue. It's not a downstream doctor issue so much. Yeah. It's a system, upstream system failure issue, absolutely.
And a lot of them, they've probably seen either, they've seen my interview with either, they've seen things with you, but they're overwhelmed with the sort of hierarchy of the medical profession telling them you have to take a statin or you're going to. And I go through all of this and I find quite often, having spent more than half my life spooning drugs into people, I'm now de-prescribing like there's no tomorrow. And what I find is that I send them a couple of presentations. Your book is going to be extremely useful in that regard. And give them the confidence to say, do you know what? Actually, it's my body, it's my life. And I'm going to make the informed decision not to take a statin and go back and see their doctor and say so.
Yeah, absolutely.
You've alluded to this, but we haven't dug into the detail, which I do want to dig into. You describe statins as a con in the book.
Yep.
Explain why that is.
Exactly what we've already talked about, Graham, isn't it? The actual benefits are grossly exaggerated. Most people prescribed statins around the world aren't high risk. There isn't a mortality benefit. They're not going to live one day longer from taking a statin in those people that aren't high risk or haven't had a heart attack, and it's not going to prolong their life. So the con is that there is an accepted understanding or belief that it is having all these benefits and everyone benefits a little, but they don't. And that's basically what the con is. I would go further. I think the cholesterol lowering industry is now at a point, and I said this on GB News last week, it's based upon fraud. Okay. So what is fraud? How do we define fraud? Deliberate deception for the purposes of financial gain.
And I want to make.
I don't think I need to elaborate on that, Graham. I think it speaks for itself.
It does, but I want to go into a bit more into this because we're dealing here with two matters of medical ethics and matters of scientific principle. Now, if you're a politician, you set up a policy or a procedure or a belief, and you spend your life trying to support it. If you're a science, you set up a theory and you spend your life trying to knock it down. And the whole basis of scientific debate is as follows, that you know, even the theory of gravity, if you wanted to go back and reprove it, you would. And yet somehow there's a sort of statin theory of gravity that's just accepted and you're not allowed to question it. It's almost heretical to question it.
Yeah.
So that's the basis, the fundamental basis of science, which obviously with my pharmacist scientific training, I understand.
Yeah.
Another fundamental aspect of science and particularly clinical trials is openness of data. In other words, we should be able to access the data as health professionals, the original data that supports the argument that there's evidence behind the use of statins, but that's not the case. And a lot of the data is hidden. So I just wanted to give you the opportunity to say a little bit about more like that, because neither of us are paranoid conspiracy theorists, but this is fact, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So this has been an issue that, as people have, you know, the BMJ, for example, has campaigned to try and get access to that data, which is kept commercially confidential, which is basically most of all of the statin trials. And that's a problem. I think more specifically, rather than the benefits that we've already talked about, the small benefits of statins, it's more about what the true prevalence and rate of side effects are, because that makes a big difference as well. And that is something that, you know, is, you know, there's commercial agreements that have been made between the Clinical Trial Service Unit in Oxford University, very influential group of scientists that are responsible for advising on cholesterol lowering and statin treatment, for example, as well as many other drugs. And those agreements that they have with pharmaceutical companies who manufacture the statin drugs. And the analyses that have been carried out by this group, again, are only the data that they've made their analyses on is only privy to those particular scientists. I think the thing to add in, which is not to point fingers to say that they're deliberately misleading people, but I think there's a huge bias when you also understand that, or certainly perception of bias, that this particular institution has received hundreds of millions from drug companies that manufacture statins and cholesterol-lowering drugs. So that's a major problem. It's a major issue.
So to be clear, we've got
to summarize, we've got the pharmaceutical capture of medical guidelines and medical education.
Yeah.
So if we go to the very root of it, that's where we start from. That dissociation needs to occur so doctors can have better quality, more independent data to make clinical decisions on patients. And this is something that's been creeping up over the years, where we have publicly funded research, but most of the research, medical research in this country, is now funded by, you know, privately funded, basically from the drug companies. So it doesn't take a rocket scientist to work out that there's going to be a huge bias in favor of the interests of the drug companies here, because they're profit-making businesses.
Yeah.
There's also a legal issue. You know, the law is both, in my view, when it comes to this, is both ethically dubious and undemocratic. Because, you know, these businesses, their only obligation is to make profit for their shareholders. They don't have a legal obligation to give you the best treatment. But as I said on GB News again last week, is that the real scandal is that doctors, academic institutions, and medical journals, those with the responsibility to scientific integrity and patients, actually collude with industry for financial gain.
So, I mean, I only learned this relatively recently, and I should have known it sooner, which is there's this one clinical trials unit, which in Oxford, who have had millions and millions of pounds from the industry, if not hundreds of millions, who have locked away the data so that people like you and me and anybody else can't actually go and investigate the original data, A, which shows the benefit, or which shows the harm.
Yeah. So we have to just basically trust their word. Yeah, we just have to trust their word, and we call this eminence-based medicine,
absolutely,
not evidence-based medicine.
I completely agree. And it's also anti-science, which is why I introduced the whole idea of the scientific concept, which is everything is done transparently. You can reproduce it, you can access the data, and you can debate, and yet debate is shut down.
Yeah. So, and that reminds me actually of a quote from Einstein, is that foolish faith in authority is the worst enemy of truth.
So when you describe it as a con, I don't think you're overreaching, and I don't think it's an unreasonable soundbite. I've independently reached the same conclusion. It's an absolute scandal, because how much harm are we doing? How much good are we doing?
Oh, we've done the harm has been spent. The harm has affected millions of people over the last 20 years. Graham, the harm is ongoing. Absolutely.
Which brings me neatly to my next question, really, which is, I think lay people have this understandable belief that things are either effective or ineffective, or that they work or they don't, or that they're harmful or that they're beneficial.
Yeah.
But I do think we should try and explain this principle of numbers needed to treat and numbers needed to harm. Do you fancy having a go at that? Because you do cover it in the book.
Yeah, I think it's just a very simple concept, is that first and foremost, I think people need to understand medicine is not an exact science. It's more a practice and art, using probabilities and data to make, you know, decisions. The body is very complex. It's dynamic. It's not static. And then when you look at drug trials, which are done to try and show whether a drug benefits, then ultimately in the results, it will give you how many people benefited and how many didn't. And that's where you get something called the numbers needed to treat for a single individual to benefit. So for statins without, in people without heart disease, and this is still based upon industry-sponsored trials, okay, where data has not been
independently
verified.
Yeah,
absolutely. There's a 1 in 100 chance over a 5-year period, roughly, that you're going to benefit in terms of preventing a heart attack or a non-fatal heart attack or minor stroke, but without a prolongation in life. And that's really what the NNT is. So everybody should really know that. I think with any pill that you're taking, you should ask your doctor, what is the NNT? What is my absolute individual benefit? And that's something that I mentioned in the book. It's really important for people to know that. One, so they don't exaggerate the benefit in their own minds. Two, so that if they get side effects, stopping the drug isn't going to kill them. And three, and most importantly, it doesn't distract from other things they can do with their lifestyle, which isn't just going to probably improve their longevity, but also help with their quality of life as well.
So that's numbers needed to treat, and the obverse side of the coin, the flip side of the coin, is numbers needed to harm.
Yes.
And in your, and again, we can't access that because we can't access the data.
Yeah, I think if people listening want a better understanding of different interventions, there's a great website which is free open access called thennt.com. And on that, you can click on various interventions for different conditions, for heart disease, for example, and it will tell you, in terms of what patient important outcomes, not pharmaceutical industry important outcomes, but patient important outcomes in terms of what that benefit is. And they also give numbers needed to light system about green, overall benefits outweigh the harms. Yellow, it's neither here nor there. And black or red, where actually, no, this is going to cause more harm than good.
And I think what I'm trying to get over to the lay audience is, if I do something or don't do something, what's the likelihood it'll benefit me? What's the likelihood it'll do harm?
Yeah.
Because it's probably, there's a risk of both. And is there an overwhelming benefit that the good side of it outweighs the bad side? And is it relevant? So not only all of that, if I control my blood pressure, but my left arm drops off, that's not a great outcome. So you want to look more broadly, is it going to extend my life? And is it going to extend my quality of life, rather than is it going to control some particular measure of whether it's HbA1c, systolic hypertension, whatever it might be.
Absolutely.
That's not an outcome in my view.
No, absolutely. And I think, Graham, the other thing on this point is to just emphasize for the podcast, for the listeners, that this is not something that is taught in medical school. I'm sure you didn't learn it when you were, you know, studying to be a pharmacist, that this NNT concept, it's not something that's taught. And it's certainly not taught that you should be having conversations with patients in these terms. Even though the World Health Organization, 2009, Gerd Gigerenzer, who was the director of the Harding Center for Health Literacy in the Max Planck Institute in Berlin, you know, he said it's an ethical imperative that that doctors and patients essentially understand the difference between the absolute and relative risk to protect patients from unnecessary anxiety and manipulation. But that hasn't infiltrated into medical practice. The BMJ and the medical royal colleges, I was the lead author in a paper in 2015 called Choosing Wisely. The initiative, Academy of Medical Royal Colleges initiative to wind back the harms of too much medicine. And then again, we call for this to be mandated in terms of teaching in medical schools and et cetera, et cetera. So there's still work to be done because it hasn't infiltrated down to the grassroots. And that's another barrier to making the changes happen that are there to improve the quality of care and ethical evidence-based medical practice.
Interestingly enough, it is taught at pharmacy school. We know all about the statistics around clinical trials, NNT and NNH. So next time you have a go at the doctors, please have a go at the pharmacists as well, because we're equally culpable, even more so, because we are taught this stuff, but somehow we forget it.